Hey guys, welcome to yet another interesting session by Intellipaat. And today we're going to discuss about cybersecurity. In an increasingly digital-driven world that we're living in today, information security is more important than ever. Cybersecurity is no longer optional but critical to the success of organizations, regardless of their size, industry vertical, and geographic location. Now, just think for a moment. Will you ever leave your home or office unattended? Obviously not, right? But when it comes to data, many of us tend to be casual. Data is the asset that powers and enables today's businesses and individuals alike. We all store data and access our data from various devices such as laptops, mobiles, documents, and so on. Any loss of data can affect the organization in terms of time, cost, confidentiality, and competitive edge. So initially, the internet was developed to build communication for the military, government, and scientific communities. But advances in technology has changed the way we live and do business. The internet has grown in the past two decades beyond anybody's wildest imagination. Our world is more connected than ever before, and this brings huge opportunities and benefits. But along with it, it also brings huge risk to the data that is stored on the internet. Criminals take advantage of technology, resulting in cybercrime at any point of time and anywhere. No business is completely foolproof. We are actually living in an era of cyber insecurity. And attacks are common. It can be a malware, virus, Trojan, phishing attack, or a DDoS attack. I'm sure you're aware of the WannaCry ransomware attack, which happened in May 2017. This WannaCry attack impacted over 10,000 organizations and 200,000 individuals in over 150 countries. So just imagine, you're seated at home, working on your computer, either answering your email or polishing a work-related presentation. And suddenly, a message blinks on your screen. The message curtly demands that you send cash to a certain destination, and failure to do so will indefinitely lock your computer and all of your documents stored become inaccessible. And like this, many organizations like FedEx, Nissan, Deutsche Bahn in Germany, Russian Central Bank, and National Health Service in the UK got affected. And they had to pay huge amounts of money to get their data back. From this incident, we understand that a threat in information security will result in loss of millions of dollars. And as we all are aware that any computer connected to a computing network is potentially vulnerable to a cyber attack. So what exactly is a cyber attack? A cyber attack is a deliberate exploitation of computer systems, technology-dependent enterprises, and internet. It achieves its malicious goal by altering computer code, data, and logic with upsetting consequences. Now let us briefly discuss about various cyber attacks. In general, cyber attacks can be classified as network attacks, web attacks, software attacks, and social engineering attacks. So what is a network attack? Network attack is an attack that occurs over the network. These attacks that occur over the network include sniffing, spoofing, man-in-middle attack, and DOS attacks. Now let us see what these are one by one. So spoofing is a method used to get unauthorized access to computers, where the intruder sends messages with a source IP address, which has been forged to denote that the messages are coming from a trusted host. A sniffer is a program or a device that is used to examine data traveling on a network. Man-in-middle attack. So as the name indicates, a man-in-the-middle attack occurs when a third person is actively monitoring, capturing, and controlling your communication transparently without your permission. DOS or denial of service attack. So in this case, an attacker sends many links or information requests to a target system to overload it. Now we'll discuss web attacks. It includes phishing, SQL injection, and cross-site scripting. So phishing technique is a combination of fraudulent emails and websites by cybercriminals to gain information illegally. It uses different techniques to attract its victims into providing information such as passwords and credit card numbers. SQL injection and cross-site scripting both are code injection attacks in which malicious code is injected into a website to get sensitive information from the database. Now let us move on to software attack. So a software attack includes viruses, worms, and Trojan horse. A computer virus attaches itself to a program or a file, enabling it to spread from one computer to another. And like a biological virus, a computer virus can range in severity. Some may cause mildly annoying effects, while others can damage your hardware, software, or file. Almost all viruses are attached to an executable file, which means the virus may exist on your computer, but it actually cannot infect your computer unless you run or open the malicious program. A worm is similar to a virus by design and is considered to be a subclass of virus. So these worms spread from computer to computer, but unlike a virus, it has the capability to travel without any human action. Due to the copying nature of a worm and its capability to travel across networks, it results in a situation in which worms consume more system memory than usual. And a Trojan horse is a software program which hides its true nature and exposes its design behavior only when activated. It'll actually do damage once installed on your computer. And unlike viruses and worms, Trojans do not reproduce by infecting other files, and nor do they self-replicate. The last type of attack is social engineering. So have you heard about this term? So social engineering is a human-based attack in which the user is convinced to reveal confidential information to the hacker. Social engineering can be divided into human-based and computer-based techniques. So human-based attacks aim at confusing people in person or over the phone and always use imitation to trick users into releasing information. For example, the attacker might pretend to be a coworker who has some kind of urgent problem that requires access to additional network resources. And then comes computer-based techniques. So computer-related attacks still target the users of a computer system. However, they do so with computer-based processes like email attachments, websites, and instant messaging. For example, a pop-up window appears on the screen saying that the user has lost the network link and the user is prompted to re-enter the username and password. A previously installed program by the intruder will then email the data back to a remote location. And perhaps these are actually the most common security threats that you'll ever come across. Now, you might have got some questions in your mind, like who plans and executes these kind of attacks? How will you come to know that your system is attacked? And how can you prevent this? Well, these type of attacks are mainly done by hackers. So what is hacking? Hacking is usually done to gain unauthorized access to a computer system or a computer network, either to harm the system or to steal sensitive information available on the computer. And the person who does this hacking is known as a hacker. Hacking can be anything that is related to internet or computer system. Some of the common types of hacking include website hacking, network hacking, email hacking, password hacking, and computer hacking. Now, let us understand what is ethical hacking. So, ethical hackers are also called as white hat hackers. They never intend to harm a system. Rather, they try to find out weaknesses in a computer or a network system as a part of penetration testing and vulnerability assessments. Ethical hacking is completely legal, and it is one of the most demanding jobs available in the IT industry right now. There are numerous companies that hire ethical hackers for penetration testing and vulnerability assessments so that the real hackers can be stopped from doing any harm. So don't you think being an ethical hacker is interesting and highly rewarding as well? Now let us see what are the tools used in ethical hacking. So we have NMAP. NMAP stands for Network Mapper. It is mainly used for network discovery and security auditing. This can be installed on all major computer operating systems such as Windows, Mac, and Linux. Using IP packets, NMAP will be able to determine what hosts are available on the network, what services those hosts are offering, what operating systems they're running on, and what type of firewalls are in use. Next is Metasploit. It is a powerful tool used in ethical hacking and can be used with command prompt or with web UI. Using Metasploit, one can conduct basic penetration tests on small networks, run spot checks on the vulnerabilities, discover the network or import scan data, and browse exploit modules and run individual exploits on hosts. Third tool used is Superscan. So Superscan is a tool for network administrators to scan TCP ports and resolve host names. This tool can be used to perform ping scans and port scans using any IP range, scan any port range from a built-in list or any given range, view responses from connected hosts, modify the port list and port descriptions using the built-in editor, merge port lists to build new ones. And next in the list is EdaCap. It supports active and passive dissection, including features for network and host analysis. It is mainly used to sniff on a switched LAN between two hosts, inject characters into a server or to a client while maintaining a live connection, and sniff an SSH connection in full duplex. Then we have Netstumbler. This is a tool used to prevent ware driving, which works on Windows-based operating systems, and it is used to identify the access point network configuration and find causes of interference. Also to access the strength of signals received and detect unauthorized access points. So these were some tools used in ethical hacking. Now let us see how ethical hacking process works. So the ethical hacking process varies from organization to organization. However, in general, the ethical hacking process can be categorized into six phases: reconnaissance, scanning, gaining access, maintaining access, clearing tracks, and reporting. So in the first phase, a hacker will gather the required information using different tools such as Nmap, Hping, and Etacap. Once a hacker gets all the information, he actively probes into target machine for vulnerabilities in the system, and he can use the tools like Nessus, Nexpose, and Nmap. The vulnerabilities are identified, and the hacker will attempt to exploit it in order to enter into the system. Primary tool that is used in this process is Metasploit. Then the hacker will install some backdoors to enter into the system when he needs access to this own system in future. And Metasploit is the preferred tool in this process. Then the hacker would delete logs of all the activities that take place during the hacking process. And finally, the ethical hacker compiles a report about his findings, like the tools used, the success rate, vulnerabilities found, and the exploit processes. Now, for instance, consider email hacking and understand how hacking process works. There are different tools and techniques available for email hacking. Let's say you're trying to send an email from your account and suddenly you receive a pop-up message to re-enter your login credentials. In general, you'll just re-log into your account and continue with your account. However, what if the pop-up message was fraudulent and it just redirected you to a different website to record your login credentials? This is called as spoofing, and this is the most widely used attack in email hacking. So how to detect if your email has been hacked? So here are some tips to identify whether your email is hacked or not. The recipients of spam emails include a bunch of people you know. And when you try to access your account and the password actually no longer works, you try to access the forgot password link and it does not go to the expected email. Your sent items folder contains a bunch of spams you're not aware of having sent. So what can you do if your account is hacked? Well, here are some tips. You can change the passwords immediately. Notify your friends not to open links that they receive from your email account. Contact the service provider and report that your account has been hacked. Install a good antivirus on your computer and update it. You can also set up a double authentication password if it is supported. So this is how the hacking process works. But how do you prevent this? Well, this can be prevented by an ethical hacker. So ethical hackers are employed by organizations to protect networks and computers from attacks. Hackers illegally penetrate computers to access private and sensitive information. Although an ethical hacker uses the same skills as that of the unethical hacker, the former actually protects the data and computer network system. The main goal is to uncover any weak areas in the system. And once a weakness is found, it is patched. As part of the cybersecurity team, the ethical hacker also ensures that the system is firewalled, security protocols are in place, and sensitive files are encrypted. Ethical hacker plays a very important role in any organization's digital assets protection protocol. He acts like a digital soldier for an organization. So, isn't he doing a great job by protecting sensitive information? Ethical hacking as a career offers immense opportunities. They're highly regarded in all digital organizations and work as information security professionals. Ethical hacking's growing demand and suitability to candidates having diverse educational background makes it an attractive field of opportunities. Once you become a certified ethical hacker, you'll get immense opportunities to work in the security field. So some of the opportunities are software engineer, information security consultant, information security analyst, network support engineer, technical support engineer, manager IT security, and VAPD consultant. And this graph over here depicts the median salary of ethical hackers. So are you excited about becoming a professional ethical hacker? Well, this is the right time to start your career and you're in the right place. Professional ethical hacking training will help you master the ethical hacking process and different attack methodologies with prevention techniques. It'll also help you to gain knowledge of IDS, firewalls, honeypots, and wireless hacking. So join our ethical hacker training course today and see your career soar to the skies. Thank you for watching this video. For inquiries, feel free to contact us.
Thank you for watching the video. Do like and share it. If you have any questions,
comment below, and we'll respond to them as soon as possible. Also, do subscribe to Intellipaat channel so that you can keep yourself updated on the latest technologies. You can also go through other related videos in our playlist. And for more information, visit our website. Keep learning, keep improving.